Okay, well, good evening, everyone. Thank you for coming out to the first of our series of meetings on presenting the results of the engineering studies that we did over the last year and a half. So I'd at this time like to introduce the presenters that we have here. First, we have Darlene Buttrick. She's with TMB Engineering, and she was the consulting project engineer. We also have Paul Malmrose. He's with TMB Engineering also, and he was the other project consulting engineer. We have Jonathan Churins with the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority, and we have Bridget Barkley with the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority. So just to give everyone a brief background on why we're here tonight and how we've arrived here, with the assistance of the Water Authority, the town obtained grants totaling $175,500 from the New York State Department of State's Local Government Efficiency Citizen Reorganization Empowerment Grant Program. The grants provided for an independent engineering study of each of the town-owned water and sewer systems to determine how best to physically manage the equipment and infrastructure to ensure safe and reliable service. After this, we received this grant, which was kind of a long process even to receive the monies. The town formed a reorganization study committee that included representatives from the town board, the advisory committees for each water and sewer district, and the DCWWA staff. And the RSC was charged with the task of developing this reorganizational study. Hi, come on in, sit down, have a seat. So the goal of the project was to determine whether meaningful benefits can be realized by dissolving the existing Town Arbors, Greenbush, and Violet Avenue water districts and transferring ownership and management responsibilities for the water systems to the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority. The benefits are considered to include the improved efficiency and quality of service delivery, professional management of long-term maintenance and rehabilitation of infrastructure, and improved efficiencies through scale and organizational structure, maintaining continuity despite biennial elections in system oversight and the management of capital projects lasting 3 to 5 years. Townwide savings as local government officials are relieved of the increasing complexities of operating and managing small water systems and thereby able to commit greater time and attention to core municipal functions. So basically, to put that a little bit more simply, you know, when I first came into office back in 2012, I was inundated with information regarding our water and sewer districts. And there had been, you know, a period of time where the town water and sewer districts had been managed by a certain individual who had provided a lot of continuity. And there was a bit of a transitional time when we first came in that we had a new water operator. And so it was just very clear to me as the supervisor that these water and sewer districts are A, very central to the health and welfare of Hyde Park residents, and B, that they needed an intensity of management that the town was not really providing. And so, you know, in consultation with the board, we had reached out to the Water Authority because, after all, they are the authority, and you know, said, you know, how can you help us? What can we do to try to up the management of these districts? And so, you know, through that process, we were able to come up with this system of applying for this grant monies. So, you know, the other factor too is that it's increasingly complex to manage these districts. There are a lot more state and federal requirements about the water quality and how one samples and how one reports. So those two factors together, you know, really lends credence to the idea that we should have someone that manages these districts that has a lot of expertise and that dedicates full time to the management of these districts. And so that is kind of where we began this process, and hopefully that's where we are ending. So part of this was to hire consultants who are here, and they did very thorough research on the state of the water and sewer districts. And for the people that are here tonight, the Greenbush, Violet Ave, and Arbors, it's you're fortunate in the sense that there's not a lot of infrastructure associated with your water districts, that they're fairly straightforward. It's primarily pipes and some other operating systems, but the water does come from a plant, the Joint Water Board plant, which is operated by the town and city of Poughkeepsie jointly. So they did do an immense job, an incredible job of doing this research. I have a book this high in my office that details the condition and comes up with a list of recommendations, both short and long term, for what either the town or if we transfer the districts to the Water Authority, they can do to address the situation to make the water quality and service to the best level that is possible. I know that Greenbush, you are a special case. Life has been very hard for you, and I really feel very strongly and very passionately that but I, you know, just wanted to tell you that we are advocating for you in every way that we can. I'll be hopefully meeting with the some of the operators of the Joint Water Board system to ask, along with our town engineer, what things that they can do to improve the quality of the water and bring down the DBP levels. So I appreciate that you're here. I appreciate that you're contributing and that you're going to be looking at this information and speaking to it, and hopefully see the sense that I do in the transferring of these districts. So with that, I would like to go ahead and ask Bridget to come on up to the podium, and she'll tell you a little bit about the Water Authority and this particular project. Thank you.
I'm just going to very quickly give some background on the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority. I assume that there are many of you in the audience who don't know our organization. We are a public benefit corporation that was set up by Dutchess County. So we are a creature of the county, but we're not a county department. We were created by an action of New York State Legislature at the request of Dutchess County to work on water and wastewater issues throughout the county. We were originally established in 1992. We began owning and operating water and wastewater systems in 1995. We now have 14 water systems, 3 sewer systems. We operate in about 11 different municipalities in Dutchess County. We serve collectively about 4,200 customers. With two exceptions, every system that the authority owns and operates, we acquired because the prior owner had some issues or problems with those systems. We've acquired systems that were privately owned, we've acquired systems that were owned by homeowners associations, and we've acquired systems that were owned by other municipalities. In every instance, the authority was asked to come in and consider taking ownership because of the problems that the system was experiencing. We've dealt with systems that have had inadequate water supply, problems with water quality, and just overall, almost across the boards, systems that are dealing with aging infrastructure. And that's something that we're finding throughout Hyde Park, throughout Dutchess County, in fact, throughout the whole country. We are dealing with a lot of problems with aging infrastructure in the water and wastewater industry. We now have a full-time staff of 20 people, including management staff. We have a licensed engineer on staff. We have licensed operators who hold the highest licenses that the state grants for operating water and wastewater systems. We have project managers, and we have accounting people who deal with the billing and bookkeeping in-house. The systems that we own and operate, we operate some of them with our own staff, and we use contract operators, as the town does now, to operate some of the systems as well under our oversight. We have currently right now an operating budget of just a little bit over $5 million. And since 1995, when we started operating systems, we've done over $45 million in upgrades, capital improvements to water and wastewater systems, everywhere from very, very small projects of replacing a pump up to construction of a $20 million water pipeline. So this is what we do, water and wastewater, nothing else. We are, as I mentioned, a public organization. We're governed by a board of directors who's appointed by the county executive and the county legislature. Like any public organization, our meetings are open to the public. We're subject to freedom of information laws, and we pride ourselves on working very hard to be accountable and accessible to our customers. We send information out to all of our customers with quarterly newsletters that go out with the bills. We maintain a website that has information on the organization. I would encourage any of you to check it out. Very easy to find, dcwwa.org. We use that to keep our customers and the public in general up to date with what the authority is doing. We have a function where we're able to send out alerts to people who sign up to receive them. So if there should be an issue in your water system or even something like routine flushing, we'll use that alert system to let people know what's going on there. So again, we do water and wastewater throughout the county. That's all we do. We work very hard to be prudent stewards of the infrastructure that we're responsible for and to be accessible and accountable to our customers. So with that bit of background, I'm going to turn it over to Darlene to talk specifically about the engineering evaluation that was done for the Arbors, Greenbush, and Violet Ave water districts. Thank you.
Okay. Hello, everyone. My name is Darlene Buttrick, and I was the project manager for this project. For the evaluation of the Arbors, Greenbush, and Violet water districts. So what I want to do is run through the evaluations that we conducted and some of the results and recommendations that we had after reviewing the districts. So just a little bit about the districts. As you all know, they're located in the southwest corner of Hyde Park, and they're both supplied by interconnections with Poughkeepsie. The Arbors Water District being in the westernmost corner with the interconnection down in this area where there are a few homes serviced along this road here, and then mostly it's the Arbors condominiums where there's about 445 residents served or services there. The Greenbush and Violet Ave water districts, which are fed by a master meter along 9G here, and then there's also a small booster pump station along Pell's Court to feed to boost the pressure for a few homes located along that road. So what we did for each of the districts, we looked at the capacity of the system, and in the case of these districts, what the agreements are for water purchase right now, the adequacy of the fire flow and pressures in the systems, the water quality, and the conditions of the few facilities that you do have in the districts. And we also looked at potential alternates for interconnections. That's not going to be the focus of any of the presentation tonight, because that's not a direction that the districts are going to go in right now, but that was something that we also looked at. And after doing those evaluations, we came up with recommendations for each of the districts, broken down into one of three categories. Urgent being items that we recommend addressing right away, either because it's an imminent danger of failure, it could be a safety issue, electrical code issue, so forth. Short-term items are items that we recommend addressing in the next 5 years, and then long-term items that we recommended being addressed in the next 6 to 15 years. And then with those recommendations, we created budgetary costs for each of those items. Just a little bit about what that included. It was a piece of equipment. It included the equipment cost and the associated demolition, removal, and then installation of the new piece of equipment, any temporary facilities that would be required during that replacement, and then a series of markups so that this was a total project cost, including any additional costs from a contractor that would need to be hired to perform the work, engineering fees if there need to be any kind of engineering documents to procure the work, owner, administration, legal, or land acquisition fees, and project contingencies. And one thing I wanted to note, when we do go over those costs, in some cases, some of those items could be addressed by the authority's own staff. As Bridget had mentioned, they have a lot of in-house people that are very capable of doing some of those things. So depending on the direction that things go, and there are some savings that could be realized. So for the Arbors Water District source evaluation, as you know, water is purchased from the Poughkeepsie Joint Water Board, and there's a master meter that meters the water into the Arbors District. The agreement capacity is 32,000 gallons per day, and that's a take-or-pay arrangement, meaning you pay for the 32,000 gallons per day regardless of whether or not you use it. And then there's an encroachment fee for any usage above 40,000 gallons per day. On average, the demand has been about 23,000 gallons per day. And over here, just a, you probably can't read the numbers, but this is just showing your average monthly usage. So most of the time, pretty far below the agreement limit. There are a few periods of time when it was above, and this was most likely related to flushing of the system. So overall, the agreement capacity is sufficient for Arbors. With there are a few additional potential services that could be added, but not too many. In terms of flushing capacity, there are hydrants located along from the meter, master meter location here, over to the condominiums location. Once in the condominiums, we found there to be inadequate flushing hydrants. But I believe some additional hydrants have been added since the time of our evaluation. In terms of fire flow, per the agreement with Poughkeepsie, they are not required to provide fire flow, and historical documentation suggests that it's inadequate. This area is supplied by a pump station in Poughkeepsie that has a capacity of about 600 gallons per minute. And the typical required fire flow for a residential dwelling, that's about one or two units per house, less than two stories, and less than 100 feet apart, is greater than 600 gallons per minute. In terms of water quality, there are issues with disinfection byproducts, as you know, trihalomethanes being the problem. All other water quality parameters meet the required limits. And Poughkeepsie is in the process of upgrading their water treatment plant. They recently signed a contract to with a contractor to install ozone to reduce disinfection. This should reduce disinfection byproducts in the system in the long term. However, obviously, it's not going to be an immediate solution. In the Greenbush area and Violet Avenue Water Districts, again, purchased from the Poughkeepsie Joint Water Board. Violet Avenue has a master meter, and then the Greenbush Area Water District is retailed via an interconnection with Violet Avenue District. The agreement capacity is, again, take-or-pay, 80,000 gallons per day, with a 200,000 gallon per day encroachment fee above 200,000 gallons per day. Right now, the average demand is about 47,000 gallons per day. Again, this figure just showing the usage compared to that agreement capacity. And there is some additional potential for build out within the existing districts, up to 91 additional parcels that are not currently connected to the districts, which would add approximately 30,000 gallons per day of additional flow, which would basically get you up to that agreement limit. So that's definitely something that should be monitored over time. In terms of flushing capacity, there is sufficient flushing capacity throughout the two districts. Again, similar to the Arbors district, Poughkeepsie is not required to provide fire flow, and it is supplied by the same pump station with a capacity of 600 gallons per minute. So the same restrictions on flow into the system. Similar issues with disinfection byproducts. And again, it is anticipated that some of that should be addressed with the future ozone addition. So in addition to those kind of desktop evaluations, we also did condition evaluations for the various facilities located in the districts. We conducted the field visits in March of 2014. We basically looked at all the site infrastructure, safety-related issues, any mechanical equipment, the building and structure itself, any support systems, electrical, heating, ventilation, and any instrumentation. And then while we do this, this is just a general, just to kind of get a feel, the real starting point that we use is what we call a typical life expectancy. How long do we expect a structure of that type to last in terms of age? And then with that, we look at a variety of other factors, one being criticality. You know, if something were to fail for that facility, how would that affect the ability to bring water into that district? The service condition, is it a hazardous environment or very wet or damp environment? Energy efficiency, you know, a particular piece of equipment might not necessarily be due for replacement. However, replacing it earlier could realize some savings in energy, so that was factored in. Any regulatory requirements to meet, you know, Department of Health standards, any safety issues, and again, age, like I had mentioned. And so I'm just gonna go over briefly some of the recommendations we came up for each district. The Arbors Water District, the primary asset is really the meter pit. It was installed not too long ago, it's about 10 years old. And overall, it's in good condition. We just had some safety and security items that we recommend. So as urgent items for the meter pit, we recommended developing confined space entry procedures and putting up associated signage so that workers are aware that it's a confined space and that they need to follow certain protocol when entering the chamber. And there's a pressure reducing valve in the meter pit that we recommended servicing. That was for a cost of $8,500 as a total project cost for urgent items. And also I want to add some of these items have been addressed already since the time of our visit, including the signage. Short-term improvements, we recommended providing fall protection equipment for safe entry. You can see here there's a hatch that's used to enter the chamber. So providing a way to hook on a harness for entry into the chamber, repainting the piping and repairing some of the supports that are aging, and providing bollards for protection of that hatch and that entry area so that it doesn't get damaged, especially during wintertime activities. So that was a project cost of $19,000. And long-term improvements, overall just repainting the piping and keeping in good condition so you can get the longest service life possible out of that piping system. The Greenbush Violet Water District physical evaluation. And again, I forgot to mention for Arbors and Greenbush Violet, all of the piping, buried piping throughout the systems are relatively young, I guess I should say. There hasn't been any history of water main failures or significant water main failures, and so it's not anticipated that they would require replacement sooner than the average life expectancy, which is about 50 to 80 years for buried water main. So for the water system for Greenbush Violet Ave, there's a meter chamber and that booster pump station that I mentioned. Overall, the meter pit was in good condition. There's similar to Arbor's, some safety recommendations. Also for the booster pump station, we had some safety recommendations. We also recommended alarms and future replacement of the pump station. Urgent items for the meter pit, similar to Arbor's, developing confined space entry procedures and signage, which I understand has already been taken care of. sealing some leaks around the piping, at the pump station, providing warning signs for the electrical equipment, noting that it is an electrical hazard, you know, and to not open the equipment without the proper protection, and rewiring some transmitters. That was a total cost of $9,600. Short-term improvements, providing fall protection equipment and installing a flood alarm for the meter pit. And for the pump station, providing a generator receptacle and manual transfer switch so that if the station loses power, there's a way to get it back up and running if there's a prolonged power outage. And then installing some security measures. It's currently an unsecured pump station, and installing alarms for flood, pressure loss, and pump fault. And I believe the alarms have since been added. And that was a total cost of $67,500. And then finally, long-term items for the meter pit, just minor maintenance items for that. And for the pump station, we recommend budgeting for pump station replacement. The pump station itself is a rather unconventional setup, and the pumps that are used aren't typical for that type of booster pump station, so they're pretty inefficient. So this is a case where replacement of the pump station on its earlier side of its lifetime could result in some future savings in terms of energy efficiency. So that was a long-term improvements cost of about $660,000. So that's everything I have for the conditions assessment portion. Do you want me to take, yeah. Anybody have any questions before the authority takes over?
Well, we were trying to save money now. All this replacement stuff.
Use the mic, please, if you want to say something. Use the mic.
Oh, no, that's all right.
No questions?
How long has the pump system been in place that is already needing to be replaced? I'm not familiar with how long the water has been supplied.
The question was, how long has the pump station been there? I believe it's been there.
There's a portable on the table, isn't there?
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
I believe I'd have to go back and double check the report, but I believe it's been there about 10 or 15 years. And for pumps of that style, the typical lifetime is about on the 30-year range. So that long-term item is really a 15 years out kind of item. So it's seems long-term, but 15 years comes up faster than you'd expect. And I guess the other part of it, too, is because they're submersible pumps, meaning that they're not above grade. They would require a crane to pull them out to really perform any kind of maintenance, which also, makes it difficult as well. It's also why I'm recommending different style of pump.
Are these pumps that were put in?
Would Mike use a microphone?
Are these the pumps that were put in 2005 when they ran the town water lines on?
Yes, I believe so.
So they're about 9 or 10 years old now?
Yep, that makes sense. Yep.
You say that the pumps that were chosen to be placed there were not the right kind of pumps. That's what I thought I heard. Something about they were.
It's not the most efficient style pump for that application.
Well, how does that happen when we've had such a long time of bad water and then they finally put in town water? It took 5 years. And then they didn't use the correct technology.
Yeah, I'm not aware of. Yeah, I wasn't part of that, so I don't know how those decisions were made at the time. It might have been a cost item. You know, it was probably a significantly less. Do you want to answer the question, John?
Hi there. This is Jonathan Kearns with the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority. Although the pumps that were installed are not typical, it is an acceptable solution, and it is meeting the town's needs at this time. One of the pumps was actually recently replaced. A little closer, is that better? Okay, if I can hear myself. Okay. So one of the pumps was recently replaced in the last 6 months, and the system is functioning correctly. It now has lightning arresters, and some of the other components were updated at the same time.
So. Who's maintaining right now, who's maintaining the water system? The town and city of Poughkeepsie, or?
All the facilities that I mentioned are owned by the town right now, and as Aileen had mentioned the town has a contract for a contractor to come in and operate the systems for the town on behalf of the town.
I don't know that was the question you're asking. Did that answer your question? Because what we have is a plant that's owned by the Joint Water Board of Poughkeepsie, and that's done on the Hudson River in Poughkeepsie. So they own that portion. All we own is from the meter pit to your homes. That's owned by the town, and we employ VRI to operate it. Okay. So if I think that's the question you were asking. We don't have control over the plant, unfortunately. So I just did want to clarify.
Anybody else? Okay. I'm going to turn things over to Jonathan now.
Thank you.
And if you think of any other questions, feel free to ask me later.
I'm going to do a little height adjustment here. Good evening. My name is Jonathan Churns. I'm with the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority. I'm a project facilitator, and I've been working with the town for the last year, actually several years, working on this project to secure the grants and then move them forward, working with the town engineer as well as the town's contract operator, VRI. In the last couple of months, we put together a study that defines how we would move these systems forward if they were transferred to the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority. For my part, I'm going to reiterate some of the items that the Water Authority would improve in the first couple of years, and for both the Arbors and then the Greenbush and Violet Avenue systems. The funds for this project do the engineering evaluation, as well as the legal work and various other components of the project, were paid for by the New York State Department of State. The funds came directly from their local government efficiency grant program, and we thank them for their funds. For the Arbors water system, there was a definite list of items that the engineers mentioned. This is a particular scenario that would lay out everything through the future that would need to be done for the system. Looking at the list based on what the town has completed and how the Water Authority would move the system forward, we find that in the first 5 years, we would be looking to do a very limited number of items in this particular system. We have service the existing pressure reducing valve, provide bollards for the meter pit. It is adjacent to the road and is potentially able to be damaged by snow activity and drivers moving through the area, so we'd like to make sure that vehicles are not allowed to park on it, as well as the inside of the facility should be scratched and painted, as well as repairing the pipe supports so that the facility can run forward without any further issues for the longest lifespan possible. The total estimated expense for the Arbors water system for these improvements included in the way we would move the system forward, the cost comes to $7,000. For the Greenbush and Violet Avenue water systems in the first 5 years, we propose that certain items need to be reviewed and addressed. This is a somewhat truncated list from what you saw that the engineers proposed. We've included, obviously, warning signs for the pump station, as well as bollards for the... Well, that's not... Sorry about that, leaned on the laptop. So we would add those warning signs that I was mentioning. The bollards would need to be put in to protect the pump station so that cars couldn't drive through the situation and further damaging equipment. We'd also see the need to include a manual transfer switch so that a portable generator could be put on the pump station should the power go out. Some of the other larger items that were mentioned with the pump station replacement in the long term, if the Water Authority were to own and operate the system, we would definitely revisit that on a regular basis with our capital plan. However, at this time, the facility has been repaired and move forward with the appropriate technology that may be not ideal, but meets the needs of the system. And so the total estimated expense for the improvements as we've proposed them would come to $8,000 within the Greenbush and Violet Avenue systems. Now I'd like to invite Bridget up to speak for a moment regarding the financial plan for the system.
Readjustment. So over the years, I mentioned that most of the systems that the authority owns and operates were existing as systems that we acquired. And the process, the model that we've developed over the years in doing that is to start out with a full evaluation of the system. We were fortunate in this case to be able to fund it through the grant. We look at what the improvements are that the authority sees that need to be made, how we would go about addressing those, what we could do with our own manpower, what would be contracted out, and overall, what would the operation of the system under the authority look like? Because we find, not surprisingly, what people are most interested in is, are you going to get good service, and what is it going to cost you? So those are the questions that we look to answer. So we've put together, as Jonathan described, what we see as the priority improvements that need to be made over the next couple of years. And now I'm going to talk a little bit about how that fits into the overall financing of these different systems. So right now, Arbors has two different sections in terms of the water rates. There are the individual single family homes that are served, and then there's the Arbors condominium. The town essentially wholesales water to Arbors condominium through a master meter. The water rate for single family residents within Arbors, a flat quarterly charge of $91.05, and then a metered usage charge of $3.75 per 1,000 gallons. That quarterly charge comes with an allowance, so up to the first 27,300 gallons of water that you use, that's included within that quarterly charge. So when we look at the typical customer in the Arbors single-family residence area, most people are using water within that allowance, so really all you're seeing is the flat rate water portion of your charge. So an average house, a typical house in Arbors, is being charged about $364 a year. Just to give you a basis of comparison, the New York State Comptroller each year releases figures on statewide average costs for water and wastewater. And for 2015, the figure they're using for average statewide water costs per typical single-family residence is $862. So needless to say, Arbors is well below that. We looked at the overall finances of this system, a couple years of actual, 2011 through 2013, the adopted budget and projected results for 2014, and then the most recently adopted budget for 2015. So that we could understand, you know, if we took the system over, what are our costs going to be compared to what historically the town has seen, what the town has budgeted for. Couple things that are notable here is that there are costs that are tending towards increasing. Electricity, as everybody knows, water systems are dealing with the same thing you're dealing with in your home. The electric rates are going up. The town has been making an effort to better understand what the cost of the labor is that the town is providing to deal with the procurements for the system, to deal with billing and bookkeeping functions, and working to assess those charges more appropriately across each of the systems. As systems age and you're working on improvements, you're not only seeing equipment repair and maintenance costs, but the associated legal and engineering costs that can go along with those. You'll see along the top row, the system as of 2013 had a healthy fund balance of about $32,000 and has been using some of that in 2014 and is budgeting to use some of that in 2015. to help offset the rates so that the rates are remaining stable. Given the size of the budget, the amount of fund balance, we think that's an appropriate use, but also people need to be aware of the fact that can't go on indefinitely. Eventually that fund balance is going to be drawn down. We just talked about $7,000 worth of improvements that we see the system needing over the next couple years. Over time, Poughkeepsie has the ability to increase rates for the water that they are selling to you. In particular, they have the ability to increase rates to pass on costs for the capital upgrade that they're making to their facility. So we see it as a system that has a sound budget, but you're at the point where over time you are going to see increases in the rates for the system. We put together a 2015 budget as a basis of comparison. If the authority owned the system today, where would we see the budget? Bottom line, annual expenses, we're seeing very similar to the amount that the town has budgeted. We do agree that it's appropriate at this point to continue to use some of that fund balance to hold those rates constant. But essentially, bottom line, if we were operating the system today, we see that the rates are appropriate, the budgeting is appropriate, and would not make changes to that under the authority for the initial year or two of operating the system. Moving on to Greenbush and Violet Ave, again, the same kind of evaluation of the overall condition, how that feeds into what we see needs to be spent on urgent and short-term improvements. And how that compares to what the budgeting for the system has been. Greenbush and Violet Ave, we tend to look at together because physically it's really all the same distribution system. It purchases water through a single purchase agreement with the Poughkeepsie Joint Water Board, but there is a different rate structure. So here, Violet Ave, between the flat rate and a metered usage charge, the typical residential customer in Violet Ave, I think there's 11 customers altogether, is paying about $300 a year. And then in Greenbush, there is a flat charge, a flat rate assessed biannually, $150 for a typical cost of $300 a year for a single family house in the Greenbush district. Do you know the number of customers in Greenbush? There's 181 service connections in the Greenbush Water District. There, as was mentioned earlier, there are additional properties that are in the Greenbush District, but not connected to the system. So again, you're seeing trends of some generally increasing expenses. The budget, the rates for this system have remained flat. Violet Ave in particular has a very healthy fund balance, about $26,000. Even using some of that to offset rate increases over the last couple years, to offset the cost of a $9,000 equipment repair expense in 2014. With that fund balance and a relatively simple system without a lot of infrastructure, we agree it's appropriate to be using fund balance in that way. And in Greenbush, also a decent fund balance, about $25,000. Between those two systems, they're looking at about $8,000 in improvements in infrastructure that they're equally responsible for. So overall, financially, the systems are in good shape. When we look at a proposed authority budget for Violet Ave, again, we're looking at expenses that are within, I think, $83 of what the town had budgeted, and again, agree that it's appropriate to apply some of the fund balance to offset some of the expenses for that system. Greenbush, we're looking at expenses slightly over what the town budgeted, but I think overall, when you look at what historically the existing rate structure has generated, it's within that existing rate structure what we can expect in revenues. Again, demonstrating that we agree that at this point it is still appropriate for now to continue to use some of the fund balance that the system has, but again, recognizing that over time, these rates are eventually going to get to the point where they're going to have to gradually increase. One other issue, jumping ahead of myself. So again, we would not, if the authority were operating these systems today, we would not propose to change the current rate structure from what the town has currently been charging. One other issue with Greenbush, there was a loan taken from the New York State Environmental Facilities Corporation, EFC, when the distribution system was originally built. There's about 9 years left to pay on that loan. And one of the aspects of this whole reorganization evaluation was to look at outstanding debt that any of the systems had. What are the options for handling that moving forward? So through the authorities, legal counsel, town council, bond council, and discussing with the State Environmental Facilities Corporation, we were able to determine that EFC would be able to transfer the existing loan to the authority, but because we are legally a different type of entity than the town, they would require the authority to establish what they call a debt service reserve fund. It's essentially, as it sounds, it's a reserve that guarantees that on an annual basis the debt service is going to get paid. Because that's above and beyond what the town currently has in place for that bond, it would be an additional expense. We've projected out a worst case scenario of the authority borrowing that money and paying it back over time. It would be an increase of $45 a year per typical residential unit in Greenbush. Again, it's a worst case number because we're still working with our bond council and with EFC to understand different options for financing that required fund if the town wanted to go forward with the transfer. So that's essentially where we see the evaluation of the systems. We don't see either any of the three systems needing any new capital borrowings over the next 5 years at a minimum. Really, in most cases, you're looking more over the next 15 years or so for that pump station issue in Greenbush. We see the systems as being financially sound, the rate structure is appropriate, and would continue to operate under those existing rate structures under the Water and Wastewater Authority. So I will stop there and see if there are questions on that part of the presentation, and then we'll talk about where we go from here.
The town operates the system now?
The town operates the Greenbush, Violet Ave, and Arbors systems, which are essentially distribution systems.
Why a flat rate opposed to a metered rate?
For Greenbush?
Yes.
Do you want to address that? Do you?
Well, originally, when the money was borrowed, I think that it was just ascertained that this would be the best way to charge, because you need to have operating meters for every property. When we first came into office in 2012, the prior administration had thought that what they would do is change the system to a metered system, but they actually didn't charge anyone, so that was one of the reasons that we had to kind of assess it backwards, because if you remember in 2012, there was it used to all be included in your tax bill, but the prior administration decided that they would take the operation and maintenance out of the tax bill and start metering people. But they never did that part, and so when we came in, we started to do that, but there are a lot of properties that don't have operating meters, so we decided to go back to the flat rate because we looked into it. It would be about $60,000 to purchase the meters so that everyone could be charged per metering. It just didn't seem like a wise investment at that point in time to add that on top of your regular operation and maintenance costs. Do you have something to add to that, Jonathan?
Yes, this is Jonathan Turns, Water Authority. Just like to add that also the town uses a particular metering technology, And if the transfer to the Water Authority was something that the town desired, and it appears to be, the Water Authority uses a different technology, and so we would like to install our meters instead of what you currently have. So we asked them to hold on installing any more meters in the interim during the process.
And the
anticipation would be a metered system.
Eventually. And the other aspect to that is that this is the first in a series of grants, hopefully, that we had to do this first in order to qualify for additional grant applications that would possibly pay for this infrastructure, for this improvement. So this was the first step, and hopefully, as we proceed, we might be able, we would qualify for additional monies that would pay for the meters, so that would the district residents wouldn't have to pay for that.
And if I could add one other piece to that, both the Water Authority and the town are eligible for those grants, and whoever the new owner is of the system or future owner would follow those up.
Now, is there a way now to kind of estimate what, you know, we're paying a flat rate now, what, once it's metered, what that, you know, difference would be in cost? I know every household is different.
Depending on usage. I don't know the answer to that, do you?
I can tell you, first off, right off the bat, the revenue needs of the system aren't going to change just because people are metered. So what metering does is it changes the way that those expenses are allocated across the different customers. So just mathematically, if you still need to generate the same amount of money from the same number of people, the average cost is going to be what it is now. There are going to be people whose quarterly bills are going to go up because they're using more water. There's going to be people whose quarterly bills go down because they're using less water. But as a whole, collectively, the system still needs the same amount of revenues to run.
It was a flat rate that we were paying to the town of Poughkeepsie for the water. That's probably why it was very easy to estimate what that payment should be.
The form that was up there before was showing the amount of water we use or what we're allocated or whatever.
Yeah.
It's a take it or leave it amount.
Yeah. Pay or take. We
only do about half of that. It was like 80,000. We're up to 47,000 or something.
Yep.
Can't that be negotiated down lower?
Well, we've looked into that. The contract it was a minimum amount, but that might be a conversation that we could have, that I'd like to have.
Yeah,
the Joint Water Board.
We're not using half of it.
Right. I think that, based on the information that I have, it was originally there's about 90 customers that are not really hooked up. So I think that's probably why they came up with that, how they came up at, with that value. Because if everyone was hooked up, that's what you would use. But, you know, we haven't done that. So that would be a conversation that we would like to have, but the contract doesn't really allow for that.
Right.
So it would be going back to them and saying, hey, can you renegotiate?
And another question is the proposal for a retirement home where Hobo is? Would that be that'd be added onto the Greenbush or kind of Poughkeepsie?
I think they're Violet Avenue, aren't they? They're Violet Avenue District.
Well, putting us all on the same, so.
But that's, you
was
know.
Was there another add-on that you said also?
Well, I think they just become a customer of the district and they pay into it, just like any of the other benefit units. So Jonathan can probably answer that better.
Yes, the Hobol property, as it's currently known, is within the Violet Avenue Water District and is already able to get water. It may have been a customer in the past, which I believe it was. And so whatever it gets redeveloped as would contribute toward the system and pay toward it. And whether the town or the Dutchess County Water and Wastewater Authority were responsible for taking them on as a new customer or it, you know, revisiting their customership, we would make sure that they have appropriate metering in place. They are a commercial property, and it would be their responsibility to install it to the specification of the rules and regs of the Water Authority or the town.
All right. And one more thing about the amount of water, the 80,000, versus we're not coming up close to that. It was contingent on the amount of houses that are not hooked up and stuff. You know, go back and negotiate. Could it have something to do with, you know, let them know, you know, you're giving us water we can't drink. What good is it?
Yeah.
I mean, it's toilet water, so on the sewer side, fine, but we don't have that either.
Yeah. Yep.
I would have to say, like, we probably use a third of the water that we're being charged for because we don't drink it.
Right.
We don't even give it to our animals. Showers are quick, and we notice what's happening, you know, red eyes, burning, skin problems.
You smell highly chlorinated.
Yeah, and so now that may raise the amount of water we would use once the system is taken care of.
Right.
But so we're actually, though, paying for the 80,000 gallons.
That's right.
Yeah. It's,
I couldn't agree more.
Just even like to write the check out last week for the water, you know.
I couldn't agree more, really.
If it wasn't for me, she wouldn't be drinking water at all because you can't carry the stuff up and put it on your pedestal. It's so heavy, you know, to move around, or the inconvenience of the whole,
yeah,
you know.
Well, I couldn't agree with you more. It's that, you know, this dates back to 9 years or so back, and actually I wasn't involved then. You said that was a five-year process of connecting, of forming the district, is that right? And so I think at the time, and as I wasn't there, so I can only put myself in that position, that the management was very concerned about making this reasonable for the people, and that's probably why they decided to connect to the Joint Water Board plant, because it was a lot closer, it was gonna cost less, and that's why they decided to go with that option. You know, in retrospect, I think that we could all agree that we wish they hadn't, but, you know, they were dealing with the best information that they had at the time. You know, I really empathize with you. I know that we have about a year and a half before it's up and running, connected to the new, with the under the system with this new way to treat the bacteria. So, you know, we're doing everything that we can. I feel like I've shared this with you guys because I learned a lot about it in the interim. And so when we first learned about it and, you know, we realized that we hadn't been flushing to the extent that we should have, you know, we immediately jumped into action and we've been flushing very consistently. We have weekly meetings with the town engineer and VRI and the water authority, and we've really tried to examine this empirically and say, what else can we do? And I share your frustration because we've upped the flushing to once a week and it has not altered the water quality.
I don't know if that's what's made it worse.
Right, but it is actually higher. Yeah, yeah. And that's partially because there are some issues within the town of Poughkeepsie and the city of Poughkeepsie that is they're encouraging them to add more chlorine to the system, and then that's increasing the disinfection byproducts.
Still using the same disinfection product now. It hasn't been changed.
That will happen in March of 2016.
Yeah.
So we have, around 15 months before that's complete. I know that I heard that they awarded the contract, so it is on schedule. And we, as I said, you know, we've tried every method that we have thought of to bring down the DBPs. But the fact is that they're entering our system at very close, if not exceeding the maximum contaminant level. So when we flush, it doesn't matter. You can't get it below what it's coming in at. So,
excuse me.
That's okay.
When the purchase of the water, the contract was negotiated with Poughkeepsie, there was no clause in there about the water needed to meet a certain standard?
There is, and we are looking at that. We're kind of internally reviewing that.
Compensation, we're hoping that
we're looking at that. One of the issues is proving that to the town of Poughkeepsie.
Proving
that the water quality entering into our system exceeds the maximum contaminant level. And because I originally, about a year ago, wrote them a letter and said, hey, you know, give us some money back here because your water quality is not adequate. And their response was, well, it has to be inadequate for a full year for it to qualify. And so we're gathering that data. Unfortunately, we don't have it for the full year. But we do have a lot of evidence that shows at least part of that year, it exceeded the maximum contaminant level. And I think that's a good argument to express to them that we would like some sort of compensation, some sort of reduction in the what we're paying to them, so that we can pass that back on to you.
Because we're paying almost double anyway for the water, because we're only using half of what we're paying for.
Right.
And we're purchasing outside water. I mean, everyone has a
microphone. Yeah. Yes, no, I agree. And then,
I mean,
so you're
I'm paying over $60 every 3 weeks for Poland Springs. Mm-hmm. And as the gentleman said, carrying it in, carrying it up, it's quite a workout.
I'm sure. I agree.
And I just wanted to ask if you were aware that this is a secondary problem, that when I purchased my house in 2000, I was at a closing while a piece of paper was being put in my mailbox that said Greenbush water is contaminated with MTBEs. So for 5 years, I had that pollution in my water and caught the state trying to cover up the amount that was in my house. And I did finally get some filters. Then the town water finally came in. It took 5 years. And then within months, we have contaminated water from the town. So I don't know how many other people in this room have gone through that and feel the frustration of just one water problem after another, and now on top of it, a bill for the water. So I know that maybe it's inappropriate, but this is the only place that we can come.
It's not inappropriate. That's fine.
Our
no,
frustration and our sickness.
I hear you.
Problems, doctor bills. It goes on and on.
So the reason that the town decided to form this water district was because of the MTBE. And so tonight I asked the Department of Health to be here so that they could talk with you, because I know you have questions. And I don't blame you for being really mad. I would be too. I agree with you. I am really angry, but I don't know. Yeah, Pete laughs because he knows it makes me crazy.
He gets very angry.
Because it seems so unjust and so unfair. And we are asking for fair treatment. That's kind of what we all were taught, right? We expect that from our government, that it would be fair and equitable. And that's not what we're experiencing now. So, you know, I did speak with Tanya Clark, asked her if she could be here so that she could talk with the people, with you, about the health risks. So it's a slightly different situation than the MBTEs, right? Because they talk about the exposure to disinfection byproducts more as a risk assessment. That's what they say when you speak with them verbally, that it's not as much a, how do I describe it? With, you know, it's based on length of exposure, amount of exposure, and then that increases your risk. And that's not what the literature we send you says, though. The advisory is very strongly worded, and yet when you speak with the officials from either the New York State or Dutchess County Department of Health, they kind of minimize that. And I think that's one of the things that people were very frustrated when we had the last meeting, is that, wait, I just received this in the mail. But then when you're here and you ask the gentleman from the New York State Department of Health, would he drink it, and he says yes, then there's this mixed message. And there's also information that there are other parts of Dutchess County that have the same disinfection byproduct levels that you have in Greenbush, but because the Joint Water Board has received a waiver because they are doing this improvements, that those people have not been alerted. So to my mind, I find that disturbing and inexplicable, because if it's a risk for all of you, why isn't it a risk for all of them? And the sad part about this is that you experience, in addition to the health concerns, the economic impact of this, you know, on your house values. And that's why I'm agreeing with you 100% that there should be some equity and it should be fair. If anyone in this county has this level of disinfection byproducts, they should all know. And I'm, even though it's a difficult situation for all of us, I think that it's better that you all know that than if you didn't. Like, I feel worse for those people who actually don't know. So the only thing that makes me feel comfortable or confident is that we have been told by the various authorities that when this is repaired or this improvement is made at the Joint Water Board plant, that you will have very high quality water. So I know, I don't blame you for being skeptical, but.
So, yeah. All right, when are we going to get some nice drinking water instead of going to Stop and Shop, getting the things of Poland Spring or whatever brand you want to have? You don't know what year or?
Oh, no, we do. It's March of 2016.
Can we write that down and
you
say
should.
Yes?
Well, you know, who knows? Maybe we'll all be going to the Joint Water Board meetings at some point and asking for that information. But we have been told that that's the case, that we should expect that, and we'll hold them to the, you know, to the best of our ability, to their word. So
I guess we can expect that, but you know,
the real
reality is water quality is never going to get better. It's getting worse, you know, getting worse just globally. So to say that, you know, we can expect to have this wonderful water,
well,
I guess the best we're going to have what the state deems is.
Is that water going to be coming from the Hudson River as well, near the sewage plant where they process it down there?
They are not changing the source of the water. The POC water plant will still get its water from the Hudson River, but the 10-second primer, if I can, on disinfection byproducts. When you have organic carbon content in the water and it interacts with the chlorine, this reaction starts that eventually creates disinfection byproducts. The older the water is, the more that reaction occurs, the higher the disinfection byproducts levels get. The changes that Poughkeepsie is making at their water treatment plant is to increase their filtration ability so they can get more of that organic carbon out of the water. And then they're using ozone for disinfection, so they'll put less chlorine in. And then at the end of the process, it goes through another level of a biologically activated carbon filter, again, to get any of that organic carbon matter out of the water that they can. So the Water and Wastewater Authority buys water from the Poughkeepsie Joint Water Board for our Central Dutchess Water Transmission Line. We send that water down to East Fishkill to a residential community there and to Hopewell Glen. They have also had disinfection byproducts problems with that water, so we have been very involved with the Joint Water Board in looking at and understanding what technology they chose, why they chose that technology, what the projected results from that technology are. They did an evaluation of water age, because that's one of the factors. The older the water gets, the higher the disinfection byproducts. So they used, for their decision making, they used a combination of treatment technology that would result in disinfection byproduct levels that were at about two-thirds of what the standard is. So a third below the allowable standard for water that's 10 days old, because based on their modeling of their system, there's really nobody that gets water from that water plant that should be getting water that's more than 10 days old. So based on the best available science that we have at this point, technology we have at this point, we believe that they did the right evaluation. We believe that they made the right decision. They were looking at less expensive treatment technologies, but that wouldn't bring the level of disinfection byproducts down as low. So they showed modeling that some of the technologies they were considering by the time the water was 10 days old would be right at or even maybe a little bit above those levels. And I have to say that they made, I think, the right decision, that they added safety buffers in so that, again, anybody getting water from that system should not be more than 10 days old and should not be close to that drinking water limit anymore. Excuse me. Other questions? What we'll do then is just quickly wrap up with where does the process go from here. So what you've seen tonight, what we've all been talking to, is this dissolution plan or reorganization study that the grant required us to create. That will be finalized. It will go to the town board. They accept it as a proposed plan. The town then holds a public hearing. So unlike this, which is a public meeting, it has a different name. It's a public hearing. It's a legal requirement under state law that they do that. Anybody who wants to come and address the town board on the subject matter, on whether they think transferring the systems is a good idea, a bad idea, or however else you may feel about it. And then the town board makes a final decision if they want to proceed with the transfer of any or all of the systems to the Water and Wastewater Authority. They all stand alone. The town can decide thumbs up, thumbs down on each system individually. If the town decides to go forward and transfer a system to the authority, then we start the process at the county level. We go to the county legislature and ask them to create what's called a zone of assessment. It's essentially a district, but at the county level, it delineates the properties that are served by that system and who collectively are responsible for the costs of that system. As part of that process, the county legislature holds a public hearing. Based on the feedback they get, the county legislature decides if they want to create the zone of assessment or not. The final step in that process is that action of the county legislature is subject to what's called a permissive referendum. And what that means is if the required number of people sign a formal petition to the county legislature asking them to put this to a public vote, then the creation of that county zone of assessment goes to a public referendum. People who live within and are registered to vote within the proposed service area are eligible to vote. 51% say yes, it's upheld. 51% say no, it's shot down, we're done. If that referendum does not happen, or if the referendum happens and the vote is in favor, then everything is in place for the town and the authority to work through the process of transferring over from the town to the authority the real property, the assets of the water system or systems. We become responsible for the accounts payable, the accounts receivable, and then the Water and Wastewater Authority becomes your water supplier. You would be our customers. You get bills from the authority moving forward. Our board becomes responsible for establishing the rates for the system on an annual basis. And that could happen in the July to October timeframe based on the schedule that we're looking at today. So again, it all goes back to that decision that the town board makes. Sometime we're expecting in the February timeframe whether or not they want this process to continue through to a transfer. And there are, as we noted here, numerous opportunities even beyond today for people to make their feelings about that known to the town board, to your county legislator, to the authority. So any questions on that part of the discussion?
I just might add too that you can call me if you want to talk about it, or email me 229-5111 extension 8, or aroar@hypeparkny.us. So, do you, It could be, I'm not sure. I can give everybody cards, so if you want to call or email to talk about it, you don't have to wait for the public meeting, is what I'm saying to you.
As we're creating the zones of assessment, could they actually be a different size than they currently are today, based on the fact that there might be people that are outside the assessment that would want good water?
So in theory, yes. In practice, if you are going to include somebody in the zone of assessment, you have to have the ability to serve them. So, you know, for the most part, the town districts are created to capture all the properties that have access to the pipes to get service.
Would be better to be an addendum at some time in the future.
It could be done in the future. You create a different zone of assessment, extend the infrastructure to serve them, and then they're responsible for that cost.
If I may also, this is Jonathan Churns, Water Authority. There's also the potential for small system additions to occur through out-of-district contracts where it's technically feasible.
Did Aileen say that, is there somebody from the Department of Health here?
No.
There is not. No.
Okay. All right. I'll reserve my question for them.
How does this transfer benefit the town, then ultimately benefit me, and then benefit you? Water's coming from the same place. Mm-hmm. The fee is going to end up being more, right? We're anticipating that.
Potentially for Greenbush with the debt issue, potentially.
Right. Would be metered. For me, the benefit would be metered water, because I know that I don't use the amount that I'm paying for. Even if it was good water, if the rates are similar to our town of Wappinger's metered property.
Mm-hmm. So the benefits to the town, I'm sure Aileen's coming back, but you know, the discussions we've been having over the last 2 years, and I think Aileen was upfront about it at the beginning of this meeting, is that these are complicated, time-consuming issues for the town to deal with. They don't have a tremendous amount of resources in terms of permanent staffing that address these issues. So you're talking about board members being the ones who are spending a considerable amount of time on these issues, that then get to spend their time on issues that impact the town residents more broadly.
The expertise of addressing that.
Right. How you as customers, did you want to add? How you as customers benefit is because the authority deals with these issues on a daily basis. This is what we do. We have the expertise, we have the staffing. There are improvements these systems need that we can make in-house less expensively than if you're going through a whole project process to make the improvements happen. You know, 2020 hindsight's a great, a wonderful thing to have. I will tell you that we would not have entered into the agreement with Poughkeepsie that the town entered into some 10 years ago under prior administrations. We have an agreement with Poughkeepsie right now to buy water from them. We buy 1.5 million gallons a day of water from them. I think we have a higher level of involvement and interaction with the water board because of that. We've been more aggressively involved in the process of the evaluation of the improvements to their system that they're making. We were able to negotiate more aggressively in terms of an agreement that does not require us to pay for water if it's not potable, that has allowances where you're not fully paying for water not taken. Poughkeepsie does say they sell water on a take or pay basis, period, take it or leave it. We have an agreement that there is a credit for water not taken, so that if you subsequently use more water, you get it at a lesser rate. And that comes from having a much broader perspective and having more experience and having dealt with issues like that in other instances. Going forward, you know, there are always potentials that there are additional infrastructure issues, additional issues with Poughkeepsie that I think we would be in a good position to be able to deal with on behalf of the customers.
Very sufficient response.
Thank you.
Yeah. Good answer.
Going forward, if you are in place, what will be the steps or what will you look forward to doing if this water quality come March 2016 is not up to standards? What steps will you go forward with to rectify that?
First would be tracking and following the upgrade being done by Poughkeepsie, that they are moving forward, that they are on schedule, they are doing what they said they were going to do, that they're not making changes to that. If they put those improvements in place and they're not performing as expected, being more aggressive in finding out what is causing the continued problems. And then in terms of alternative solutions, we have looked in the past at the issue of whether there is any treatment outside of the initial water treatment facility that would address disinfection byproducts. The options are limited, but they're are not non-existent. And looking at renegotiating a contract with Poughkeepsie, looking at alternative water supplies if they can't meet their obligations to provide potable water. You know, one of the fundamental problems, and we see it across the county, when one municipality is dealing with another municipality and they've got the resources, they've got the infrastructure, and you're the customer, you don't have a lot of leverage with them. And I've seen it, frankly, with Poughkeepsie. They run their system for the benefit of their constituents, and if they can make a little money selling water to somebody else, yay. But that's as far as it goes. You just do not have the leverage with them. When you're looking at an entity that works at the county level, we have other ways of leveraging things with the city and town of Poughkeepsie. We're their biggest outside customer.
And if the change should occur, would the contract that the town currently has be null and void and you be negotiating a new contract?
The contract is written that it's an assignment. The town can assign it to another entity. The Poughkeepsie Joint Water Board has already said that informally in discussions that they would agree to a transfer of the agreement as it's currently drafted. But if we were looking to renegotiate it, they would want to know, they would not automatically agree, obviously, to a renegotiated contract. I think it is an opportunity, though, to go back to the Joint Water Board and address some of these issues in that context.
And the current term was on the contract, do you remember?
They generally do 30-year agreements.
What, are there any other options? Is there any other water treatment facilities? Was that the only
choice
at the time, Poughkeepsie? You know, is there? I'm just curious. Is there other?
So when Greenbush was created, one of the options that was considered was connecting into the Hyde Park Regional Water Plant. Our Water and Wastewater Authority owns and operates that. We have water lines that go across St. Andrews Road and then north on Route 9G. One of the things that the engineering evaluation looked at for the Pinebrook Water System, which is between you and St. Andrews Road, Greenbush and Violet Ave, would be the potential for interconnections. Another piece of that is that there's an area, Holt Road, between Pinebrook and St. Andrews, where there have over time been water problems. So one thing would be to look at all those areas collectively, and if all those properties were sharing in the cost of an interconnection, translating that down to the level of what a cost per household would be. You know, right now we have basically the infrastructure cost to connect Greenbush, to connect Arbors. So that would be an evaluation that we would do. You know, the only other public water supply source in the area is the Pine Brook Water System. They do have good water quality. They do not have sufficient capacity to serve a significantly expanded area. So, you know, that's really where you are with the options.
Has the Dutchess County Resource Authority ever considered going back and looking at available Superfund monies, since the original problem was we were all poisoned by the gas companies on Route 9G? We entered in negotiations with DEC, the Superfund, and we're given a choice to take this less cheaper avenue. And while as a customer, we keep getting asked to contribute more and more for a problem which was initially caused by the gas stations along 9G. Has there been any time when an agency such as yourself has been able to go back to procure Superfund monies to help alleviate this and do these upgrades? I mean, when you did the cost analysis, we're already up to $100,000 during the course of the initial installation. We discovered there was rock in Hyde Park, and there was another couple $100,000 put on top of that estimate. Right. And now we're looking at 67,000 improvement, 8,000 improvement for already designed pits that aren't up to standard. And, you know, it's easy to go and shake our pockets, but, you know, I'm just wondering if there was any opportunity to look at Superfund money.
I will tell you that we wouldn't rule anything out in terms of looking for where there might be funding. I wouldn't be very optimistic about Superfund money. I believe that most, if not all, of the original money for Greenbush came from the New York State DEC spill response program, since it was a leak from a gas station. I think what you would probably expect to be told by them is that they funded a solution to the problem, and that if there are subsequent issues, you know, you can't go back to the original source. Again, I wouldn't rule out anything, but I think for the most part, anybody you go to right now is going to say, well, you know, your problem is from the water in Poughkeepsie. They're spending $20 million to fix that problem. It should fix it. I don't think you're going to find anybody that's going to be overly eagerly give you money to go in a different direction at this point. If for some reason the Poughkeepsie solution doesn't give you the relief, then I think it's fair game to go to anybody and everybody and say, all right, you know, where's the support now to find an alternative solution?
Along the same line, I seem to remember there was a large meeting at a public school where the EPA was held responsible for allowing and letting these gas stations get away with this pollution. And there was a class action suit put in place. Whatever happened to that? Do you remember? Does anybody in this room remember that meeting at the public school?
Yeah, I was there. Avalon was over half a year.
Yeah, I was there. How they let us down and nobody was being held. The organizations that were supposed to be responsible for keeping our water safe did not do that, and they were never held accountable. And now you're right, our pockets are being shaken and shaken and shaken. What happened to those agencies and organizations that were supposed to be doing that for us, that we already pay for in our federal taxes?
I wasn't part of it then, but how much money came from?
Folks,
they got it. Just keep it down, and that's how we start.
That's the reason he's so thin, because he just runs back and forth. But so Pete, you know, you were involved back then.
Sure.
That, what was the total project cost at that time? Do you recall?
The total project cost of the
system? For the Greenbush system.
Oh, boy. I thought it was in the $3 million range.
Okay, and how much of that came
from the... We got $1.9 million from the DEC fund. And I think what you're referring to, I'm Pete Sotero, by the way, I'm the engineer for the town. I think what you're referring to, I believe, is that the DEC was going to go back after what they called the principal responsible parties.
Right.
And I believe there was three or four of them, you know, the gas station owners. And whatever happened with that, I'm not 100% sure. I believe they were going to go back to see if they could recoup some of the $1.9 million that they, you know, had put into the project.
You can use that money now.
Yeah, I don't know whatever happened with that, honestly.
So if the total project cost was around $3 million, and you think we got about $1.9 million,
yeah, then, you know, the district had to make up, you know, the difference.
And that's what's, so we borrowed the money. That's what your capital cost is. That's what you pay on your taxes. That was to pay for the installation of the pipes,
the water
and
lines,
the water lines, and all that. So that is, you know, but then you have this operation and maintenance cost. And that is for running the system, for buying the water. And, you know, we are doing a lot of flushing, which costs additional monies to do that. But, you know, it's not solving it, but it may be working to some extent, because it could be a lot worse if we didn't do the flushing. I think that the flushing is helping somewhat, but it's not addressing it totally, because again, it's starting at the plant, and so we can't get it below what they give us. But I just kind of want to speak to something that I think you mentioned, Bill. You know, all these engineering reports, as I said, we have a thick book, and I gather that people feel that things were not done properly or adequately, and I wouldn't say that that's the case. Okay, I mean, just really trying to be objective. I think the town really tried to make the right decision. They tried to keep in the equation what the cost would be to the district residents. That's why they didn't go with the more expensive option.
Well, yeah, I mean,
right, and so I just want everyone to realize that every single district that we've looked at has major and improvements that are required. And that's the cap, that's part of the maintenance, and it's part of addressing deferred maintenance and just the upkeep of all these districts. So I know Jonathan has.
If I could just chime in for a moment, if we were to go back to the slides that showed the improvements for the Greenbush Water District that the Water Authority would like to move forward, it does not include a replacement of the pump station, which was that $663,000 amount. We see the current installation is appropriate and something we can work with to move forward. So at some point in the distant future, it may need to be readdressed in its typical lifespan. But for now, it is an appropriate solution.
But out of all the districts, Greenbush and Violet Ave and the Arbors are on the very low end for what's needed. And if you look at some of the others, it's extremely involved. And so, you know, while yes, there are things that need to be done or should be done, it's not necessarily what's driving the real problem that we have in the Greenbush District, and that is the water quality from the water that we are purchasing. So I think that people should feel, in some ways, you know, kind of reassured that that list was a fairly short list of urgent, short-term, and long-term. And just to speak to one final thing, I think what's exciting to me about this project is, you know, when you were asking before about additional customers, that there is a potential, you know, connection for Greenbush, Pine Brook, Holt Road, the parts of 9 down by the World Gym or Planet Fitness. So, you know, maybe that is something in the future that all of the residents would benefit by, and that would be much easier to be effectuated when you have a single owner like the Water Authority.
I could add one more piece to that, if the interconnection were to occur to the Hyde Park Regional Water System, there's potential that fire flows could be provided to that area from the 1 million gallon storage tank that's on St. Andrews Road. The system would need to be appropriately designed. It may require a different pump station and other components to be added, but it's all a part of a future study if it's necessary.
And then just one final thought is that if, as Bridget mentioned earlier, the average residential home cost for water is around $800 per year, you know, we are looking at significantly less costs in this area, and I think that was purposeful. I'm not sure what the average cost is in, you know, for the Hyde Park Fire and Water, but I think it's probably about that 800. So, you know, these are all factors that go into it, so.
When you talk about joining these two districts or connecting, would you be mixing the water then?
So if we were to interconnect the Greenbush Violet Avenue water system with the Hyde Park Regional Water System, it would be a change of source. And so it would be the Hyde Park Regional Water System providing the water as opposed to Poughkeepsie. Okay. At this point, we believe the best solution, though, is to move forward with the improvements that Poughkeepsie is recommending, and they should address your issues. You know, when we talk about a potential interconnection, it's probably a future item that requires other areas to be in agreement that they would like to come in. So the Holt Road area identifies that they have a water quality issue, whatever that be. They recognize that they have a cost to connect. They take their portion of pipe. Pine Brook becomes a contributor to that and brings a large customer base with an existing distribution system. They no longer have their treatment plant. They believe that it's better to connect than replace their treatment plant at some point in the future. These all are components that go into making a cost-benefit analysis of whether or not this makes sense, and obviously water quality is a part of that. But it is a future thing. Having common ownership across all the districts helps to make that a possibility in the future, should it be something that the district residents want, and it makes sense economically, and so on.
All right, just one more thing, and that is, so that the amount of water that we pay for and the amount of water that we use as a town, is that included with all the flushing we're doing also of the water, and we're still using half the amount? Yeah.
But you guys are probably using very little too, right?
Right.
If you think about it, right, that because people aren't using their water like they normally would be, so that probably reduces it. But yeah, that does include the flushing. And as we have continued to increase the amount of flushing, and we are even exploring additional options with, you know, we're looking at constant flushing or, you know, certain things to try to drive this DBP number down, so.
Aileen started out by saying some things that would be better if the Water Authority took over, and Bridget added to that, but maybe I just thought the continuity that this lady talked about, some cost, and Pete brought in, it was some principles that were being sought after or gone after. The Water Authority is better equipped as a non-changing board, as an entity that exists for 20 years now, and the town board is an ever-changing environment, and sometimes between administrations, things do fall off the edge of the world. And so in the long run, as a water board, they would be better suited to meet your needs.
You know, I know so much more about water and sewer than I did, and I was someone who barely passed earth science, so it didn't come naturally to me, but it's actually been a very valuable process. And you know, we've been here for 4 years, this is my third year. That's long in terms of Hyde Park politics, but I think that's a very good point. It's Rich, that, you know, that is a certain advantage definitely to the Water Authority, that is that historical knowledge and that longevity. You know, thank God that we have Pete, because he does provide that. And as I mentioned, VRI came in, we came in new together, and there had been an operator for some 30 years who knew these districts like the back of his hand, apparently, but nobody, he didn't communicate it to anyone else. So we were all at a disadvantage and had to get up to speed really quickly. And I, you know, just want to thank, you know, Mark Rao from VRI and Pete and Jonathan and Bridget for all the good work they are doing and dedicating time to this, you know, trying to solve this problem. And, you know, we're just trying to do our best. And it might very well be that at some point we may all, you know, want to go to the Joint Water Board meetings and let them know how that we are expecting some sort of results. Yeah, results and maybe a little payback, too. Yeah.
And I also learned an awful lot about water in just an hour of being here, you know. I can imagine what you've had.
It's a lot more complex than anybody would think. Well, so thank you, everyone. And again, you know, please contact me, contact the Water Authority, and we'll be in touch, okay? So have a good night, and thanks for coming out.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yep. Thanks, Bill.